Hello, my name is Stefan, and this is Japan at War. Now, last week we covered the deep-rooted problems of Ming China, but this week we go back to Japan. The year is 1587, and Toyotomi Hideyoshi's dream of united Japan with himself as its undisputed lord was almost a reality. Now, much of the main island on Honshu he had already claimed, further succeeding his usurped master, Oda Nobunaga. Now, Shikoku had been subdued in 1585, and in 1587, the stronghold of the Shimazu family in the southern island of Kyushu had fallen to him, with Tsushima thrown in as an afterthought. Now, the only real work left to him was the resistance of the Hojo family in the vicinity of modern-day Tokyo, and the northern provinces of Dewa and Mitsubishi. Neither really posed a real obstacle. In fact, their subjection was only a matter of time. So in 1587, the reunification of Japan was nearly complete, with a new era of peace about to begin. Now, that thought had to be unsettling for Hideyoshi. I mean, war had made him the success he was. And how and what would he do in peacetime? Hideyoshi had no intentions of finding out. And just like Nobunaga, he viewed the unification of Japan as only the first step in the conquest of Asia. Hideyoshi's confidence in himself was great. And when he talked to foreign nations, he would actually refer to it being his destiny, that it was preordained at his birth. And political considerations at home may have actually reinforced this for him. See, unlike Nobunaga, Hideyoshi did not conquer Japan simply by crushing his opponents. He relied as much upon appeasement as military strength. See, rival daimyo who swore allegiance to him usually kept most, if not all, of their lands, and could even earn more by helping build the armies to help subdue Hideyoshi's enemies. It was a compelling way for him to push rivals into allegiance with him. It made many eager to serve him. But this strategy had its drawbacks. See, his vassals had began to regard greater land holdings as their just reward for serving him. In the late 1580s, these were dwindling, and with no further battles to fight, these veterans would begin to plot, scheme, and even form secret alliances in order to gain more power and more land. But he wouldn't give them that chance. If they needed war to keep them busy, then he would give it to them. And as soon as he possessed all of Japan, he would send them to Korea and then China. This would give him an almost unlimited base, with him and Clan Toyotomi secure at the top. And in 1587, he began. Neighboring Korea was his first target, but his first choice of weapon would be the pen and not the sword. Hideyoshi drafted a letter to the Koreans, calling them to submit to him or be invaded, writing, and I quote, "By fast ships I have dispatched to Korea to serve the throne of Japan. Should Korea fail to serve our throne, I have dispatched the message that I will punish that country next year." And this letter was actually sent to his wife and his confidant, One. The fast ships that had been sent by Hideyoshi's newest vassal, the daimyo of Tsushima, So Yoshoshige, so had sworn allegiance earlier that year, together with Shimazu Yoshihisa, and was now responsible for relations with Korea. Tsushima's long relations and proximity to Korea made the So family perfect for a diplomatic role. But it also put them in a difficult position. See, they had for a long time made considerable wealth through trade with Korea and would have loved nothing more than to have that trade between a now unified Japan and Korea flourish again, with them taxing cargo that passed through their gate. But Hideyoshi was not concerned with trade. I mean, he wanted to own the country and preferred to bully the kingdom into submission, thereby avoiding a very costly war. And it was a technique that had actually worked in the past with the Japanese daimyo. But if Korea did not submit, there would be war. Now, what could the So do? They were far better informed than Hideyoshi of the nature of Korea, such as that it was a fiercely loyal tributary state of the Ming, and looked down upon Japan. And their master's demand of surrender would not have the desired effect. Now, at this time, there would have actually been some doubt whether Hideyoshi actually meant what he said, too. Or maybe that it was a cheap attempt to subjugate the Koreans with empty threats. And if that was the case, all that would happen would be to alienate them further and then damage the So family's relationship with the Joseon court. It was for these very reasons that prompted So Yoshishige to alter Hideyoshi's first message to the Koreans in 1587. His letter demanded that Korea submit to him and send a tribute mission as a sign of respect. Now, So softened this into an easier request for a goodwill mission. He also distanced himself from the message entirely by sending a family retainer, Yutani Yosuhiro, to deliver the message instead of himself. Now, Yutani was a mistake. He was a big man, around 50, with graying hair and a beard. He was very hardened from years of civil war, too. Now, he could command armies, lead assaults, but he knew nothing of diplomacy and nothing of how to win over the Koreans. The trouble actually began soon after arrival. On his way to Seoul, he made a habit of loudly demanding the best room in every inn, which was incredibly bad form to the Koreans. And when the men in Indong gathered on the road with spears, he actually laughed at them and said, "The shafts of your spears are indeed short." Now, this statement was actually true, but it was still disrespectful and obviously has the ring of an insult. Now, Sang Shu, the aging prefect, treated him to a feast. Yutani actually commented on the host's graying hair, wondering why a man who had never seen battle would ever turn gray. The insults and rude behavior continued in Seoul, confirming the prejudices that the Koreans had about the Japanese, such as that they were ignorant, arrogant, and uncivilized. But also, like the warrior Yutani, they were also dangerous, and that they had to be treated with the greatest of care. So Yutani was not run out of Seoul, as many Joseon government officials would definitely have loved to do, but instead he was comfortably housed and well-fed while the Koreans debated how best to proceed next. Now, at this point, the Joseon government knew nothing of Toyotomi Hideyoshi, the unseen power on whose behalf Yutani had been sent, and the contents of Hideyoshi's letter left them with little inclination to find out more. Even after So's attempt to soften its message, the Koreans still found it rude and lacking in diplomatic protocol. Hideyoshi boasts in unseemly fashion of how Japan had come wholly under the grasp of me and me alone. He expressed dissatisfaction that Korea had been remiss in sending missions to Japan, and he now called on them to mend their ways and send an envoy to Kyoto. It was such an unacceptable document that the Koreans had difficulty in deciding how, or even if they should, respond. The king of Korea, Sonjo, was still confused as to how any of the events that led, of any of the actual events that even led to Hideyoshi's rise to power. And in fact, he was of the opinion that they should send the envoy away completely, without anything. And others agreed that the Japanese were beyond hopes of ever becoming civilized, and that there was nothing to be gained from extending a friendly hand. Now, after keeping Yutani waiting for several months, the Koreans actually sent him back to Hideyoshi with a note, explaining that they would be unable to dispatch the requested mission because of the length of the journey and uncertainty of the way to get there, which was a very transparent excuse. Hideyoshi was furious. He charged Yutani Yoshihiro of being in league with the Koreans and had him and his entire family killed. So Yoshishige was also punished, though not as severely. He was deposed as Tsushima's daimyo and replaced by his adopted son, the 20-year-old So Yoshitoshi, who, being the son-in-law of to one of Hideyoshi's most trusted generals, Konoshi Yukinaga, was actually considered more trustworthy. And that is where we will leave you. The first mission, a complete and utter failure. But it does make you wonder, would Hideyoshi keep having his messages changed? And how many people are actually going to die in this process? Find out on the next episode of Japan at War.